You're wrong.
Okay. Where to begin? Well, I grew up with chefs, so I had a father that was a chef and also a grandfather. And my grandpa, he owned a Mexican restaurant here in Indiana. So, and also my father, he grew up with learning and all that and also doing his own thing. And I remember growing up, like about 7 or 8, I used to follow him in the kitchen and like always ask him a million questions, which he probably got annoyed by it. And I used to ask him like all sorts of like, what's this? And he used to tell me it's tomatoes. I was like, no way. And you know, it's just, it's fun to learn about different foods and learning it not by myself, but with a father that was willing to, able to teach me, I guess. And also my grandma, she used to go around and meet her garden and all that. So I learned a lot from that, like beans and potatoes and cabbage. So I learned a lot when I was little. So I don't know. Let's see. I help out with my church garden, which is in Lafayette, Indiana. It's in Eagles Creek. Eagles Creek. And they have a really big portion there, and they do a lot of tomatoes and lettuce and onions and other things I can't think of on top of my head. And I also do the help with my grandma start up the weed care garden that's on 38th and Madison. And I helped make these lasagna beds and helped start that up and got that going. And I guess my grandma can talk more about that too.
Well, this is the results of many generations. This is what you got to look forward to. As a teenager, that is a joy. It really is a joy to see her interested in gardening, for one thing. And probably there may be one or two of you remember Victory Gardening during the Second World War. I was a child at that time, and everybody in our hometown had Victory Garden. And my father was a very good gardener, and I can remember going, we didn't have but a lot with our house on it, and so we had to rent land to grow our garden. And I remember him renting about an acre of land in the northern end of Montezuma, Indiana. It's right on the Wabash, right off of 36. And I can remember going to the garden with him. But what I really remember is having to wash all those cans. the children's job was, my mother had barrels and barrels and barrels of ball mason jars. And the children's job was to give it the first wash, which was to get all the buds and the spiders and stuff out of cans and wash them as clean as you could get them. And then the next job was my grandmother and my mother's three sisters. When it came harvest time, we set up shop in the yard. We had a great big cauldron in the backyard that they sterilized the ball mason jars with. And my grandmother had a summer kitchen. Anybody know what a summer kitchen is? Mm-hmm. You know, it was too hot in those days. You didn't have air conditioning and you didn't have electric stoves. It was gas or coal or wood. And so you had a summer kitchen which was open, and that's where they done the canning. I can remember those days. And then when I became an adult, our first garden, we got married June the 3rd, and by the next week we had a garden in, which was a little late. his mother had strawberries, and I think I ate every one of them. She had to ration me on it. Because, oh, I was so hungry. Oh, it was so nice to have the garden there, you know. But you've heard this story. You've heard people say, you know, no matter where I serve my guests, they like my kitchen best. Well, that's our family. It doesn't do any good to say, get out of the kitchen, I'm busy, because they're in the middle of the kitchen. It doesn't mean just the women, it means the men too. Every one of my brothers knows how to cook, and they'll let you know. You know, they'll let you know what they want in this or that or the other. And so, in our family, my grandmother, in the 20s and the 30s, she had a bakery. So my mother and her sisters learned how to bake breads, yeast breads, and biscuits and pies and cakes, and they was noted for their pies and cakes in Montezuma, Indiana. Didn't get any farther than that, but I think they could have at one time, but they didn't. And so then my mother had restaurants until from the time I was about 12 years old until she passed away, she had restaurants. And so we learned how to treat people and how to encourage people, you know, eat more, have a piece of pie, have a piece of cake, you know, whatever. But that was natural for us because if you sat down at our table and you didn't eat at least two helpings, my mother was insulted because she was a very good cook. And my father, I'm sure some of you know this, but you know, we used to have meals together. We all sat down. We had breakfast together, we had lunch together, we had supper together, and we all sat at the table and everybody had their place at the table. My father was here, my mother was here, my oldest brother was here, just around that way, you know. And my oldest brother, he loved food. Well, you know, in the 30s, food was scarce. If you didn't grow it, you didn't hunt it, you didn't gather it, you didn't have it. And so what was on the table is what you had for the whole family. Well, when we sat down, my oldest brother, by the time it got around to the end of the table, he was ready for seconds. And when half of us hadn't had a bite to eat, and Dad would say, young man, you wait till everybody gets done with their food. And he'd throw a fit, and Dad would send him in the other room. And so, and then we had a brother who nothing was ever good. And we knew we had the best cook in town, you know, but nothing was ever right for him, and she had to cook him something else every meal. He was squirrel bad. And the joke of the family was he was a blue baby, you know. Do you know what a blue baby was? Well, it's nowadays, it's RH factor, and he was the third child, and when he was born, he was blue. And my grandmother fed him with an eyedropper for 6 weeks. They stayed up around the clock, and his incubator was the stove. And they put the lid down. They put the lid down on the oven, and had a basket, and they put him in this basket, and that's how he survived. And so I'm going back. This is the result of all this. And so, so anyway, I appreciated the good food that was in our family, the friends that we had. We would have the family in. I had an uncle, my mother, there was four sisters, and my uncle, he was the only boy. And so the sisters was very proud of their brother. And they would fight for his praise of whatever they made. And so whatever they made, he'd say, well, Virgil didn't make this. Well, Sarah didn't make that. And, you know, because Grandma, she always made the yeast biscuits and the bread. Have any of you ever seen yeast biscuits made for about 25 people at home? Well, that lump of dough is about this big around and about that high. And they could make that. And I know some of you women know that they would squeeze these biscuits off just like this, just as fast as you could go. I can't make an yeast biscuit. I can't make a pie. Can't make a cake. I have plain homemade food, and I have a lot of it. And friends always like to come and visit because we always had a nice table. So when this last year, I'm getting around to this garden. This last year, IUPUI had a teaching about gardening, and several of us in our neighborhood, the Near West Collaborative, there's four neighborhood associations involved, but the whole community was invited to come to these classes. So we went to these classes, and one of the first people we met was Laura, and she was such an inspiration because it brought back all these memories. And so then I was very interested in doing the garden, and the interest that the community had. My son works for USDA, and USDA is promoting gardening in every community that they can get a toehold in. They are promoting gardening and fresh foods and vegetables because of the obesity of our nation, and not eating good. And so when I was telling him about this, he told me his side of it. So when they came up with the lasagna gardening, how many of you know that about lasagna gardening? It's very interesting, isn't it?
Awesome.
And believe me, our garden does not have any weeds. We done it right. So with the lasagna gardening, my grandchildren was staying with me they'd be with me a couple days a week, and so they got, I got them interested in helping, and this summer Melody has stayed with me, and she's been involved in the garden at church and at school and at White River Gardens. And it's been very interesting how she has taken to this work and how she's learning. And we take things for granted, but these children don't know. They don't know where food comes from. And she's just getting all kinds of interesting tastes for food, tastes that she's never had before. And so this has been a wonderful experience, a wonderful life. And I appreciate my family. We've just been a poor family that appreciated good food, and it has been handed down from one to the other. And I believe that Melody is going to be very interested in the future. I'm interested in seeing what her future is going to be with food because she's getting interested in it. And that's our story.